I have included 7 different chapters that we are going to go through. So in the first chapter, we are going to see Hollywood stars that were involved in aquatics and water safety. And in the second chapter, we are going to see Hollywood films that involved, that depicted drowning incidents. And then drowning episodes in antiquity, in Greece, and mythology. The world history of resuscitation. The history of drowning in the Bible and the Christian Orthodox religion. The world history of swimming. And the world history of drowning in terms of art. So let's go through all of these chapters. So the first chapter shows Hollywood film stars that were depicted in aquatics and safety. And we can see, reviewing the literature, that famous artists that we have seen their films were lifeguards in their youth. One of them was Sean Connery. Another one that acted as Tarzan, Gordon Scott, was also a lifeguard before he was picked up by some Hollywood producers who liked him as a physique and asked him to act as a Tarzan. Clint Eastwood, he was a lifeguard in his youth and swimming instructor, and a very popular swimming instructor. All the mothers wanted to take their children to his swimming classes. Jack Nicholson was also, he did many different work and jobs, like in toy stores and other quite modest jobs, and one of them was lifeguard. Buddy Ebsen, that you might know from the Beverly Hillbillies, he was a popular actor in the past. He also worked as a lifeguard. And you hopefully, possibly know Alexandra Paul from Baywatch TV series. She has also worked as a lifeguard. But apart of those people who worked as lifeguards, there were some Hollywood stars who also performed lifeguard rescues. And one of them is the former US President Ronald Reagan, who worked for 7 summers at the Lowell Beach. And he did about 77 lifeguard rescues. Not so many people know this, surprisingly. And he was a great lifeguard. Greg Bonner, at the top right, is the creator, director, and producer of the TV series Baywatch. I have a very often communication with him because he is the chief judge of the film review committee of our film festival. So he is having the final word about which films are going to be the winners for the various awards we have. And in one of our conversations, he told me with pride that he is working as a lifeguard for 40 years. And during the filming of Baywatch, one child became unconscious, and he stopped everything he was doing. He jumped into the water, brought the child at the surface, resuscitated while towing back to the safety, and the child was saved. One of his lifeguard colleagues, Michael Newman, they were working together. Greg Bonner asked him to play in this Baywatch film. So lifeguard who became a film star. And Telly Savalas, known as Kojak, in the previous older generations. He's Greek?
No.
No?
No, I knew you would note that.
Ah. Well, I hope that my hair will not go that way in a few years' time. Anyway, he had to resuscitate at the pool an unconscious, no-breathing child, if I remember well, unsuccessfully. And because of that, he was feeling guilty for the rest of his life. There are Hollywood stars who performed life-saving rescues. And what is the difference between lifeguard rescue and life-saving rescue? Lifeguard rescue is when you are working as a lifeguard and your main care is prevention. On the other hand, when you are not certified and you are not working and something happens and you try to rescue the person, you are called lifesaver, amateur lifesaver. You just try to help someone. So this is what happens with Charlie Chaplin during one of his films, where he was actually trying to depict drowning episodes. There were a few drowning episodes during the filming. A young girl was watching the filmings, positioned on a rock, and she fell accidentally into the water. So Charlie Chaplin had to perform a real rescue, which was successful. Johnny Weissmuller, Olympic winner, a very important person in this Hall of Fame. You know his history and his memorabilia in the museum. He was never a lifeguard, but he saved twice people. In one event, he saved a young boy. When the boy opened his eyes, he was like that, and the only thing he could say was Tarzan. In a second incident, Weissmuller was training with his brother. His brother was in a small dinghy, and he was following him, timing him in a lake. At the same time, there were several dinghies with children and women and mothers that submerged. They started singing. So it was a little chaos at that time at the lake. So the two brothers tried to pull out as many children and mothers as possible. And from 30, 40, I don't remember exactly the number, they pulled out safely several of them. So because of these heroic actions, he got a honorary lifeguard position in the local lifeguard club of his area. On the top left, we see Robert Mitchum and Marilyn Monroe during the filming River of No Return. During the film, Marilyn Monroe is actually saving Robert Mitchum as part of the script. But in reality, Marilyn Monroe fell in the water accidentally, and Robert Mitchum, who was starring as actor as well as acted as director of the film, took the powerboat to go to Marilyn Monroe and rescue her. And then a standby lifeguard who was there for the needs of the filming assisted as well. So most of the work was undertaken by the standby lifeguard, but because they wanted to give publicity to the film, they said that Robert Mitchum assisted the standby lifeguard as well as Marilyn Monroe. This is how it works. Some other actors that drowned, or film or television stars. We see Carol Wayne, who was actress in the past. You might have said the story of Natalie Wood that I haven't included in the picture. She died, she drowned in a mysterious way during a night in hypothermic water, and we don't know if it was accidental or not, because she was in the yacht with two other men. People from the shore heard the cry for help, but they couldn't identify who was where, and apparently they were unable to help. Jessica Savitz was the anchor woman for TV news for several years. She was a very well-known person. Unfortunately, the car where she was in together with another man fell accidentally to the water, and then they were pulled out dead. So you can see the photo of the car over here, as well as her face. Joe Flynn died at his home, at his pool, and Orville Redenbacher, did I sound Greek? It's always difficult for me to pronounce the name. He died as well at his jacuzzi. He was very famous for a TV commercial that he made promoting his popcorn product. And people were were trying to understand if he was actor or if he was the real owner of the of this business. In the chapter two, we are going to discuss about some Hollywood films that depict aquatic emergencies and drowning incidents. So we see here recent films like The Guardian with Kevin Costner and Ashton Kutcher. Many drowning episodes are depicted in this film, this very nice film. In The National Treasure with Nicolas Cage, we see at the end of the film a cave being flooded and they need to find a way to escape before it will be too late. So Ed Harris is sacrificing himself to keep the entry of the exit of the cave open and available until everybody else will get out. So they are all in danger and at the end Ed Harris drowns. At the bottom left we see the Titanic, another popular film where we see several emergency episodes. It is very interesting to say here that hypothermia was the main reason of death for most of the people of Titanic. But at this moment in time, the authorities and the contemporary, the science of that period was not well developed, so they were classified as drownings. But then they realized, how can they be drowned if they are wearing life jackets and they are floating, lifeless? So then they realized that there is an additional variable, hypothermia, that may lead to drowning and even enhance the drowning process. So of course some people might have drowned, but most of them died from hypothermia. And then we see this film, The Perfect Storm, which can teach us a lot of things about the drowning situation, about the overestimation of the personal limits. These people took risk to go to fish out there when they knew that it is going to be a hell because of the incoming storm. Older films like The Submarine Command, where we see again lifeguard drowning episodes, The House of the Haunted Hill, where at the end of the film a man is trying to scare a woman who betrayed him. So he's moving using an invisible mechanism, a skeleton, like what you see at the picture. And the woman is so scared that the skeleton is moving in a dark room. She's moving backwards and then she falls inside a tank, a water tank, and apparently drowns. Bottom left, Boudou Saved from Drowning. This is a very, very nice film that you can watch from an aquatic perspective. It is available actually in YouTube. So if you click, if you write the name of the title, you will see the film and the drowning scene. A homeless tramp is desperate from life, so he decides to end his life and he jumps from a bridge to drown. Many people are watching, no one wants to get in the water, and a goodwill person who is witnessing this from his home window runs away across the street, jumps into the water, and tows the poor tramp out of the water safe. Where apparently here, again, this is Hollywood, in Hollywood everything can happen. It would be impossible in a real situation for someone who doesn't know swimming to stay so many minutes afloat until it can be rescued. Well, in Titanic, we saw so many kisses and hugs before Leonardo DiCaprio eventually disappeared from the water surface. So everything is possible. In Pandora and the Flying Dutch, we see just a very small glimpse of drowning episode. We see during the filming a dead body out of the sea next morning, and people that visited the beach are around the body. So it's not actually a drowning incident. But there are so many films that I'm going to discuss in my final oral presentation on Saturday that I'm going to discuss about Hollywood, where you will see myths and truths about what Hollywood tells us about drowning. Other films, Leave Her to Heaven, a child is swimming behind the dinghy. A woman is inside, the child is tired, the woman doesn't like the child and leaves this young boy to drown. Nightmare on Elm Street 4, old film, we see a homicide drowning episode. In The Adventurer, film with Charlie Chaplin, there are three or four drowning episodes at the same scene. People keep falling over a dock into the water, and Charlie Chaplin gets into the water and saves one after the other. And here, in the drowning pool, we see Paul Newman with a young woman. They are trapped in changing rooms, and the room is flooded, and the water is rising, and they cannot find a way to escape. At the end, they open a hole at the roof, and they escape from there, if I remember well. But at the end, they survive. This is the good news. No, someone else opened the door, I think. So the water ran off, and the room, you know, the water level dropped down, and they were saved. In Superman, Lois suspects that Clark is Superman, so she wants to test him. She's throwing herself in the water intentionally to see if he will be transformed and rescue her. And he realizes that, so he finds a way to help her save herself without him actually doing the rescue. In the Pirates of the Caribbean, we see Keira Knightley falling from the, how do we call this?
Lightning.
Yeah. Being pushed from Captain Barbossa, who is holding the sword. And in the water, which is behind the scenes, there was a standby lifeguard with his rescue tube who approached her, gave the rescue tube, and brought her back to safety. Because apparently she was wearing her clothes, she could not swim back to safety in an easy way. But we don't see this. We know it only if we buy the DVD and watch the extras. In chapter 3, we see drowning episodes in antiquity and Greek mythology. Hylas was seduced from the water nymphs. He was part of the Argonaut exhibition. So the ship stopped to take some water, and he went to the lake, and the nymphs started calling his name, Hylas, Hylas, and he heard female voices. He was seduced, trying to approach them. He fell into the water and drowned. I spoke about this picture earlier today, Leander and Hero. They were lovers. They lived in different parts of Hellespont. Hylas was swimming to find her. I thought that we live in a society where we are talking about equality, so I would expect that they would both swim and meet at the center of Hellespont. But this is something that did not happen apparently in antiquity. It was a male-dominated society, so he had to do all the length to find her. That's a Greek joke, possibly you didn't understand it, that's why you didn't laugh. Anyway, that night, the torch that she was lighting to direct him was blown away because of the wind, so he couldn't find his way and he drowned. She wanted to follow him in the other world and committed suicide by drowning. Odysseus, you know him from the Trojan world, and he's returned back to Ithaca. There are various drowning incidents taking place during his return. Most of the times, his crew members were drowning. In this, when his ship was destroyed, he was the only survivor because of this semi-goddess Ino, who applied their rich rescue and saved him. And here we see Frito Martyrs, who was also called as a sweet virgin, who tried to escape from the sexual harassment of King Minos of Crete Island in Greece. But eventually she survived drowning because goddess Artemis preferred to transform her into a fishnet, so she didn't drown. Danae was thrown into the sea to drown with her son. Guess from whom? From her father, who was a king, and didn't want this child to be alive because of a legend that said that this child would be a threat for him. So the father of Danae put herself and the baby in a box and threw them into the sea, but eventually they were saved. Poseidon, as I said before, has drowned most of the crew of Odysseus during their return back to Ithaca. The ship of the Argonauts is sinking, drowning all its crew members, and we see at the photo one of them is trying to survive by swimming. And here, you might have heard this story from Greek mythology, Narcissus, who fell in love with his image while I was watching his face on the water surface of the lake. So he fell inside and he drowned. In his honor, a goddess made him a flower, which has got his name. Antinous was another famous historical figure of the past. He was a very young boy, and he lived in the palace of the emperor Adrian. Adrian was fully in love with the boy, so much that Adrian's wife was so jealous. So the boy was his lover. He took the boy during an exhibition to Egypt, and for mysterious reasons, the boy drowned in Nile River. The emperor was so upset that he created coins with the face of the young boy on them, statues, and named Andrianopolis several towns. So he gave the name of the boy to several towns. So this is how the name of this boy survived until our days. And he treated him as a god. Zeus or Hera, the top two gods of the 12 gods in Greek mythology, threw Hephaestus into the sea to drown. They didn't like him. But fortunately, he was saved. At the bottom left, we see a picture that depicts the Battle of Salamis, a very historical battle that stopped the Persians. In this battle, the Persians did not know swimming. So when they were thrown into the water during the battle, they drowned. Whereas when the Greeks were thrown into the sea, they survived because they were good swimmers. And I have seen while writing the books that for Greeks in antiquity, to swim, it was as normal as walking. So if someone did not know swimming, people could swear to him, saying, "You are so useless that you cannot even swim." It was a swear in antiquity. And here we see a very rare depiction on a vase of shipwreck survivors. The ship is upside down, and they are trying to avoid drowning as well as to be eaten by a big fish. The next chapter, we are going to talk about the history of resuscitation. I'm not going to pay so much attention because I have a different lecture that I will dedicate on the history of resuscitation tomorrow. But let's see a few techniques. We see the heat method. They are used to apply heat to reward the patients, the apparently dead people. They use with the fumigation method to blow smoke into the anus of the casualty to generate some response. This method, it's very, very old. Westerners took it and used it. And apparently when it had success, it was not because it was a real effective method. It was possibly because the apparently dead person was not really dead. So some people were saved and they thought, it works. Let's do it again. The flagellation method, it was quite violent. So again, apparently some people were not dead and they used to wake up when that kind of punishment, that violence was applied to them. The bellows method, you blow air using this instrumentation into the casualty's mouth. And then we have the inversion method, the trotting horse method, barrel method, Dalrymple method. I'm going to talk in more detail tomorrow. Holger Nielsen, Van Steve, Van Brosse, Van Francis. Okay, next chapter talks about the drowning episodes that are included in Bible and the Christian Orthodox faith. We see in this picture Jesus saving Peter, who tried to approach Jesus, but he lost his belief. So while at the beginning it was okay, then he started being up and down, appearing the classic drowning symptoms. So Jesus Christ said, "Why have you lost your faith?" And he applied the rescue method to rescue him. We see Moses, baby. He was thrown in a river to drown in a basket. But the good thing is the basket did not sink, and it ended where the daughter of Pharaoh was with her waitresses. She felt sorry for the baby and said to one of the waitresses, "Please take care of this child and I will support you." So this is how Moses survived and was helped. In the battle of at Pont Milvius, a very historic battle, very classic picture. We see, the picture is not very clear, unfortunately. You see in the middle of the picture a white horse, and the horse's rider has fallen into the water, drowning at the middle of the battle. And this was an incident that determined the end of this battle in favor of the team whose leader was still alive. And we see in Christian references Saint Nicholas saving many sailors, and this is why Greeks have Saint Nicholas as savior and protector of all the seamen in navy and mercantile navy. The Great Flood is a very well-known incident to all of us. It is supposed to have killed through drowning the inhabitants of Earth, except Noah, his wife, and his children. And apparently this must have been an actual event, because many civilizations report a great flood where everybody drowned. It must have happened, but people describe it giving different names to the survivors. In Greece, instead of Noah, we have different names. The story is the same. And then Jonah here was eaten by a big fish when he was thrown into the water. And he survived drowning because he was in the belly of the fish. So this is a successful drowning episode, a successful outcome. In history of swimming, we see here several depictions. A man is trying to swim impatiently while his boat is approaching Athens. Other pictures you will see at the museum, a man dives from a height, which is at the Etruscan tomb of hunting and fishing. Enslaved African swimmer. Here, swimming activities or non-aquatic activities that lead to drowning episodes. Some of them are fictional, some of them are mythological, some of them are actual events. Like this, the drowning of Nantes is an actual event. Thousands of people were thrown into the water to drown intentionally because of a riot, personal madness. You know, other people collect butterflies and stamps. Everybody in this life has something to keep busy. So, because I like so much water safety and aquatics, in my life I try to bring those two disciplines together. So I say, what's the relationship with water safety, with you, this object, anything I can find around? I try to see how I can link it. So I try to find the relationship with Hollywood. What does Hollywood tell us? What art does say about water safety? So in one of my current research studies, I am trying to see statistically what the paintings say, what messages come out, which is what I presented earlier today. In another study, I am trying to find what Hollywood films tell us, what hidden messages are coming to us through television and screen. Things that we haven't thought that they come out. The film directors know very well that the subconscious can work even for less than 1 second video footage. So it comes so fast in front of your eyes, you don't realize, but in the mind, it's recorded. Now I'm trying to swim in deeper waters in terms of research, and I'm trying to see what messages the songs tell us about aquatics, water safety, lifeguarding. So I found 47 songs that talk about lifeguarding, 1,000 songs that talk about drowning, and another 1,000 songs that talk about swimming. So I found all these songs with the lyrics, and I try to bring together and see what they tell us. Do they talk about real lifeguarding, real drowning, or it's I'm drowning in your kisses, I'm drowning in your heart, you know, metaphorically. Is it ready?
Go ahead. Don't move that. Uh-huh. It's got to be plugged in.
So, let's see a little promotional video that I made that hopefully might give you ideas to promote your work if you are book authors, or give me good feedback if you are filmmakers. Checking my directing. Imagination. Thank you. attention. I don't want you to keep asking me questions here, because I know you are tired. So we have a very short book signing section outside, like what happened with Lisa before.